graduated and is now an assistant professor at University of Pitt.
Pittsburgh, yeah, Professor Pitts at Pitt.
Yeah, awesome. So good. Really nice to see you. Thank you for coming today. In terms of announcements, we always do that at the beginning. This is Todd Kuchen. He's not here today, so he sent a slide for his announcement. The Convention on Biological Diversity is promoting an online discussion on public awareness regarding what they call living modified organisms, which is their term for GMOs. And here's some information about participating here. He wanted to make this available to our community. I think it went out in an email, but we wanted to emphasize this as well. If you're interested in participating, there is a process to join this online forum, and so it's best to contact Todd to figure out how to navigate that best. Anybody participated in these sorts of things before? Anybody in the room? You have? Anything you want to say about what it's like?
It's interesting.
It's interesting. I bet. Yeah. Ours is a kind of community that would certainly add to this discussion, and so we want to encourage you to think about being involved. We don't have colloquium next week because it's spring break, and technically this is a class. The following week will be Nora Hahn, who's a professor in anthropology who's been active with GES for a number of years, and she'll be talking about issues of lobbying and advocacy and working for change, which is, I think, a neat perspective to bring in. It's just a reminder of how diverse our group is in terms of what we think about and the kind of work we do. Any other announcements before we move on for today?
Be sure to check out the GES website. There are lots of talks and things that our faculty are doing, some locally and some in places like Boston and Ottawa. So if you're traveling to those places, maybe you'll go see them there. But Adam was speaking last week at the Museum of Life and Science, and Jason's speaking tomorrow for a faculty leadership talk. And so, always fun things happening, if this is your idea of fun.
Right, and Patty does a really amazing job of putting together announcements that are informative and attractive and fun to scroll through. So thank you for doing that. That's really a great addition to our center. So today our speaker is Megan Sear. She is a PhD candidate in zoology, working in John Godwin's group. Megan came to NC State as a graduate student in 2013, same year I arrived, but we met in 2014 when she became an IGERT fellow. So she was part of the cohort of IGERT students who focused on mice and island biodiversity. And what's cool about Megan's pathway here is that that's remained really central to her work. And she's really embraced the interdisciplinary nature of the GES program in some important ways. I mean, I think what's a neat example in terms of Megan's work is that her science is very disciplinary based. I mean, she's working on questions that fall into the discipline of zoology. But her work has gone much beyond that discipline. So she was part of the cohort group who produced the Mice on Islands website. A number of people in the room contributed to that. It's a really amazing resource in terms of thinking about genetic engineering and other approaches to reducing the impacts of mice on biodiversity on islands. And if I remember correctly, Megan also co-taught an undergraduate course on science and society with actually Elizabeth Pitts, which took Megan way outside of her discipline in terms of thinking and teaching. And so she's really an excellent example of the kind of training that we offer to graduate students here in GES. And Megan likes frogs. Check out her ears if you're not sure. Okay, so Megan, please take it away.
All right.
Thanks for being here.
Thank you so much. So when there was a call and a interest in speaking at a colloquium, I was super excited because it's not often you get to tell your side of the story, right? So I decided to frame this as Awakening the Faring Strain, When Lab Mice and Wild Mice Meet. So some things I'm going to focus on today. I'm going to start out with where it all began with this IGERT mouse cohort. I'm going to wrap in G-Bird, which you heard a lot about last week if you were here. I'm going to talk about the Mouse of the Islands, the House of Mouse and other stories, and the strength of the strong mouse. So looking at that statue there and these titles, anyone know who wasn't around yesterday in our lab meeting who I'm referring to? That statue is in Oakland.
Jack London.
It is Jack London. Yes, thank you. So one of the most famous quotes, if you Google Jack London, old longings, pneumatic leaf, chafing a customs chain, again from its brumal sleep, wakens the pharynx strain. So I hope to talk to you today about what it means to waken the pharynx strain, at least when it comes to talking about wild and laboratory mice. So for starters, why am I talking about mice on islands? Over 80% of islands have invasive rodents. And they are a huge detriment. These are invasive. They were often brought there as stowaways on ships. And they cause lots of problems. So this is that chart you might have seen last week, the threatened island biodiversity database. And every red dot you see is an island in the world that has documented invasive house mice, so just house mice. So that's not including all the other islands that have other invasive rodents as well. These rodents are a huge problem, particularly to native seabirds. And so I'm going to be kind of talking about what happens and what are the traditional ways to get rid of them. So primarily, the traditional way to remove them is rodenticide. Especially if you're talking about a larger island, it's much harder to try and trap. And even bait and traps are much harder. And so what they tend to do is aerial broadcast of these rodenticides. So what you see in the top is South Georgia Island. It is the largest island to date where this method has been applied. They are still on the two-year waiting hold, almost done before they quite declared a success, meaning they haven't seen any other rodents. So this is rodenticide-based bait. Primarily, it is what's called second-generation anticoagulants, such as Bordificum. I will point out that there is a higher failure rate for mice, probably because mice have smaller home ranges, which means you have to deploy this more. The aerial use is not applied where there are people, right? So if we're worried about people, children, livestock. There are off-target effects. So the very species that you are trying to protect, right, you need to be considered. Sometimes this has involved massive holding of captivity of species until they can be re-released. There are also animal welfare concerns because this is an anticoagulant, death can occur over days. So I will point out that it has been successful for uninhabited smaller islands, but there's been some arguments over can this continue as far as the scope and are they reaching the limits of this kind of technology? So that brings me to where I come in. I am part of the mouse cohort, as we've affectionately called ourselves. I was sitting actually in this very room, right where Jen is sitting, about 6 years ago when I first heard about this project. And they were talking about eradication on islands. And the thing I couldn't stop thinking about is what's an island? So coming from a biology standpoint, an island could be just across the highway, right? And I hadn't even actually heard of these devastating impacts of rodents until I came to one of these colloquiums and started learning about these things. So I've learned a lot over 6 years, and this cohort has been instrumental for that. Our title was Genetic Engineering Society, The Case of Transgenic Mice. And one of our overarching questions is, what does genetic engineering have to offer to this invasive rodent problem on islands? So back in the summer of 2013, we went on a trip out to California, and one of the first places we went to was Catalina Island, where we actually did some surveys asking people what they thought about genetic technology. We then went to the Channel Islands, the Santa Cruz Island. We got to meet the Santa Cruz Island fox, which was really cool. We then went to the Bay Area, where we saw that Jack London statue in Oakland, where we stayed. We went to several places, including what will become important later on in the talk, which is the Farallon Islands. So, as referenced by Jason, we do have a cohort website. We worked very hard and very collaboratively to come up with a website that I personally, if I don't toot my own horn, I think does a really good job of kind of blending all our voices together. In fact, at times I even have to pause now to go, wait, what part did I write? And so I feel like that's a show of a good job of collaboration. We designed this website for open-minded skeptics with agency. So that was kind of what we were aiming for. And taken from the website, that this explores the use and impact transgenic mice may have on wild mouse populations, ecosystems, and human society. I'll point out to you that this was before the CRISPR days. So CRISPR was known, but we weren't thinking of that at this time. And so if you go on this website that was linked in the colloquium newsletter, you'll see about a different technology, the one I'm going to focus on today. All right, so before there was G-Bird, there was a cohort, and there was six of us, and then there was five of us, and then it was really wrestling with some really intense ideas. And so there up in the corner is Greg Backus, one of my former cohort, iGRIT cohorts, who's now at UC Davis working on a postdoc. And so that's my idea of wrestling with ideas, right? So he, this top one was his, so this is taken from his dissertation. Ecological modeling was something he was really interested in. Genetic engineering to eradicate invasive mice on islands, modeling efficiency and also ecological implications. Rene Valdez, who you may have seen speak in the fall, looked at international news media and the framing of invasive rodent eradications. Elizabeth, Carolyn, and I, who's also in our cohort, presented at a conference talking about animal rights and technology of mice and reagents, standardization, variation, and quality of care. And for those of you who don't know, Jack London was actually a huge supporter of and concerned with animal welfare. In fact, he was one of the first people to kind of lobby for this to be taken out of circuses for certain animal rights. And so I kind of have a nice tie-in there. And then recently, Carolyn is the first author, like you. We have an article that came out with the Gene Drive group, developing gene drive technologies to eradicate invasive rodents from islands. All right. So it was five graduate students working on graduate degrees in very different disciplines. And I think we made a really good website, and we were pushing. And then before you know it, it gets really complicated really fast. And so in 2016, the genetic biocontrol of invasive rodents formed. And so this was presented to you last week, the different groups. I'm just going to highlight that small slice of the pie, which is the TRSRY and mate choice that I'm going to be talking about today. And so as we dig into this, just keep in mind that this is a whole other project. There is a great website on there that was highlighted last week, Google G-Bird. So the genetic techniques are what I have been focused on as far as looking into different types of strains of mice. Both techniques that I'm going to talk about briefly involve biasing the sex ratio so that you can suppress the population. In theory, if there's not enough of one sex, right, the population is going to dwindle because they're not mating. I want to point out to you that a gene drive is something that biases inheritance of a gene, and so it requires it this way almost all offspring inherit the gene. Oftentimes they're thrown around or called selfish genetic elements. And then I'm also going to talk about something slightly different, which is intragenomic conflict, which is where sometimes it can promote its own transmission. And so that is what I'm going to be mostly focused on today. So these two techniques being proposed, one is the CRISPR technique, so using a synthetic gene drive. The other one is the one that is highlighted on our website and I have primarily been focused with, which we call the TSRY. This is a meiotic disorder. It uses a naturally occurring selfish genetic element, the T haplotype. Both of these goals is to, again, bias the sex population. And I just want to keep in mind, because there is a lot of hype and excitement, that neither technique has been developed yet, that we're still in those working processes while questions are occurring. So this is the Y shredder. This is the technique, and the goal is to make simply all female. So if you could make and bias the population to be all female. Paul Thomas from the University of Adelaide is leading up this project. And again, the goal is to make all females. Well, how would you do that? Is what if you could destroy the Y chromosome? So we know that males have an X and a Y, and you need at least one X, right? But what if we get rid of the Y? And so the thought here is to destroy that chromosome so it can no longer function. And what you get here is an XO. And these females, at least in laboratory conditions, are fertile. So in this case, they are an XO female. So in this case, you would have all females. In order to make this a gene drive so that it could penetrate in the population, you would need to incorporate those gene drive instructions, such as the CRISPR-Cas9, the guide RNA, into the mouse's DNA. So I just wanted to remind you that CRISPR can be used like an editing tool, but it can also, in this case, be used as a gene drive and keep spreading in the population. There has been some modeling done that suggests there might be a benefit of a single release, but again, that remains to actually be seen. So that's it for me and CRISPR. I'm happy to get more into the genetic details afterwards, but I was going to switch over into more of the project I've been looking at, which is this TSRY. And this is the opposite. Instead of all females, the thought is, what if you could make all males? So David Threadgill is the PI on this, and Donna Kanavy, another graduate student, part of the organization as well, have been working on this technique. This is a little bit different. This is where you're using a meiotic distortion. This is a naturally selfish element that's present in wild mouse populations, but it's not very common. What it is common, though, however, is it's common and it gets passed down very highly in that part 95% of the time. So unlike the normal, you have a 50% chance of inheriting, this is going to be inherited 95% of the time. The thought is to place this SRY gene that I'll talk about in a moment into the gene drive, into the TW2. Modeling by Greg Backus and others have suggested that most likely you would need multiple releases and it would take a longer time to eradicate. There's also a question of how effective is this naturally present meiotic distortion. So the SRY gene is the male determining gene or the testes determining factor. And just that single gene allows for the initiation of male sex determination for mammals. So the thought is, well, if this makes male, if you were to place it on any other chromosome, an autosome, a non-sex chromosome, then even if the mice were XX, they would still be a male because they have this male gene. They'd look like a male, they try to reproduce like a male, that they'd be sterile. So this is a way you could make a mouse male, but that's just making one mouse male. So again, in order to get it into the population, the thought is to use this TW2. So the TW2 haplotype, again, it's naturally found in populations, but it's not that common because we know there are some fitness costs to it, that it tends not to hang around in populations. But if you were to harness this for a particular population, what you would be looking at is this naturally occurring distortion. So the way I like to think of it, I like to call it sperm wars. It's a poison anatode system. So you think of this sperm, those sperm that carry the T lay down a poison to make all of them kind of weak swimmers. But those that have the T also carry the antidote, and so while they're better at swimming, they're going to be the ones that fertilize. Those that don't carry the T, the wild type as we call them, aren't going to be able to get there because they don't have the antidote. They just have been laid down by the poison. So again, the normal chance of inheritance is 50%, but what they see in these populations in the wild is really high 95% of the time transmission of this T. So there's Donna again. She's been working really hard on her PhD over at Texas A&M, trying to get the SRY gene into the T haplotype. So again, the goal is to make an all-male population. The males that inherit, that are XX, and have the SRY, right, with the T, they would be sterile. Those that are XY will just pass down the T to the next generation. So I promise that's as genetic-y as I will get for now. I'm happy to follow up with questions. So where does this leave me? Well, when I first started this project and I first heard about all of this, I have to admit I was pretty confused. And then when we first started, we didn't even have mice. So it's been a very long, interesting road. So when we went to the Farallon Islands, one of the reasons we wanted to go to the Farallon Islands is because we knew they had really, really high mouse densities. And so when we started this project and we started talking about, well, we want to look at wild mice and we want to get some wild mice, hey, why not the Faroe Island Islands? So we needed a wild mouse population. So this is me on the sailboat. They only let me do this in the harbor, and I begged them, but they relented. And so this is me on the sailboat that took me out to the Faroe Island Islands, a really great story as well. In this case, I was able to collect and bring back some of these Faroe Island mice. I do want to point out that they have incredibly high densities. Some people have described it like the ground is crawling. So we wanted to look at a really high mouse density population. The current plans are actually on hold. Their current hope is to eradicate with that traditional means that I showed you earlier, using rodenticides. But there's been some hangups and it's been on hold for a good period of time. So once we got mice, then we had to find a place to house these mice. And it turns out that people who work on lab mice aren't always as happy about working with wild mice. And I'll show you a video in a little bit which might help explain why. And we also grew mice pretty quickly to the point that we needed to think about building what I affectionately call our mouse barn. So here's some wild mice. You'll see them shake their tail. That's a defensive mechanism towards each other. All right. We also call them our popcorn mice because they love to jump. So they're pretty wild. So this leads me to, hopefully this is still working, the House of Mice and Other Stories. So we had these mice and we really wanted to test them, but we didn't want to test them in a standard laboratory environment. We really wanted to see how do they act in more of a natural environment where we have more of a, you know, seasonal variation, we have some natural lighting, those kinds of questions. So this is where the mouse barn started. And this is John building said mouse barn. With the help of my husband and myself and lots of carpal tunnel syndrome. And then this is our working, functioning mouse barn with all these little cages that you'll see highlighted in a little bit. So we have mice from the Faroe Island Islands, and we were actually in the middle of this year-long construction, right? Was it a year? I think it was about a year. By the time we got approval, lots of things, right? It was also in a greenhouse in the summer in North Carolina. Yeah, fun times. So we were building this mouse house, and someone kind of mentioned, well, how do you know that they'll mate with the lab ones? And it was like, oh, yeah, that is kind of what I'm interested in. And then it was like, well, of course they'll mate, right? They're mice. And mice are mice. These are both the same species, right? But then there were some concerns because, again, as you just saw, those mice are wild. And then if you've ever seen a lab mouse, you can pick it up by its tail. You can just move it around. It rarely even makes a noise. And then the other concern is some of these studies have shown that they do a sort of mating where they only want to mate with certain mice, even after just a few generations. So this is actually a really critical question before we could move forward. And so what I did was I took 5 laboratory mice, and each male got 2 females that were from the Faroe Island population, and I mated them. And as you saw on the GES colloquium, there was a great cartoon highlighting this, but here's the real deal, right? This is what we got. So we got pups. So we know that these wild mice from the Faroe Islands and these lab mice will indeed mate. Here's your cute, adorable pups. So this led me to be able to continue with my dissertation. Yay, good. And it's really brought me to this point here where I feel like I have basic approaches to some really important applied questions. And one of them is if we are considering using this T mice, right, these T strain mice, will they reproduce successfully when in competition with wild direct males? So how competitive are lab mice if you compare them? I mean, they seem pretty different. And then if not, if they're really not competitive, what degree of back crossing would need to occur in order to make a competitive wild hybrid lab mouse? So this brings me to one of my favorite parts of the Mouse Barn, which is these little arenas here. Sorry, I'm gonna backtrack a little bit. Which brings me to these little arenas. And so before we ever started to see how competitive they were, we just wanted to, again, kind of quantify how much they were actually made. So our Mouse Barn, as it's affectionately called, by the way, I meant for Mouse Garden because it's in the greenhouse. I was shot down. It doesn't happen. We have actually different strains of mice now. So we have the MMF that I'm going to refer to. These are wild-derived island mice. They're from the Farallon Islands, so that original population that we took back to North Carolina. They're eighth generation now derived from the wild. And so I have been working with these, and then we call MMF, the Farallon ones. These six are the most common laboratory strains of mice. And so that was the first thing I did, was I took these B6 males to these Farallon females. That's where I had my first success. Now, I also have TW2 mice. So these mice are the mice that carry the natural haplotype. They are not edited like Donna's trying to do. They just simply have the naturally occurring T. So they're B6 background with a little bit of a different lab background, and they just carry this T that's going to cause that meiotic distortion. Now what I've been doing is I've been mating these Farallon females with these laboratory males, and I get F1 hybrids. So an F1 hybrid is a 50% wild background. Again, it's a Farallon female with one of these lab with the T males. And then what I do to get the F2 is I mate one of these males, again with a Farallon female, so that I'm generating a 75% wild background. So again, my question is, how wild of a mouse do we need? So once we knew they would indeed mate, we started looking at, well, how do they compare when they mate? And so I have for you a couple of brief slides to kind of show that really, if you're trying to create a competitive mouse, we're maybe on the right track. So that cross litter sizes are comparable to these purely wild-derived litters. In other words, the Farallons, in terms of litter size, is equal to the hybrid 50% and the hybrid 75%. So they're producing the same amount of pups, which is good, right? It's not like they're producing less. That would be a huge concern. When it comes to these pups, we weigh them at their weaning age, and so that's usually 21 days of age. And what we do see, interestingly, is that these hybrid pups are larger than the Farallons at weaning. And so now we see that regardless of what type of hybrid, 50 or 75%, F1 or F2, they're larger than the Farallons. And so maybe being larger is an advantage, right, if you're a mouse. And this trend continues. So adult weights, while they do vary by strain, we still see that hybrid males are larger than the Farallon males when they're adults. So we know in these standard laboratory cage shoeboxes that they will mate, and we know that we have some comparable things in terms of litter size and even higher weights than the Farallon ones. What else I've been doing is screening for the T haplotype. And so we want to make sure that indeed this is being transmitted like 95% of the time. So just to kind of show you what I've been screening is I do these gels where I run out the DNA. And what I'm looking for is a difference in these base pairs, how many base pairs they have that separate out on the gel. So a wild type mouse, a regular Farallon mouse, is just going to have one band. But a mouse that has the T is going to have two bands here, one that's the wild type from the one parent, and then here's the T. And so I'm going to look for how many times is this actually being transmitted. So these are my results. So when screening, when I take a V6 female, just a lab female, and a T male, 98% of the time they're inheriting the T, which is consistent, right, with this 95%. The Farallon female with the T males to get my F1s, 97% of the time. The Farallon female with an F1 to get the hybrid F2, 96% of the time. Again, normal inheritance would just be 50%, and because of this sperm wars that's happening here, we see this huge distortion occurring with the T. So this brings me to the strength of the strong mouse. It's one thing to know that a mouse is bigger, and it's one thing to know that they'll breed in laboratory, but how competitive are these males? So I'm going to show you a brief clip, and then we'll talk about these arenas. It was really just for me to get an excuse to play the Rockies. So, so what are these arenas that I am calling? What they are 8-foot by 4-foot enclosures where we can put multiple mice in at the same time to have a much more larger, realistic environment in terms of size. These are about, I think, 60 times the size of a regular lab cage. And so what I've been doing is I've been trying to see, well, which male is more competitive? So I take 2 Fairlawn females, so I give them something to fight over, right? I have one that's a Fairlawn male and one that's an opponent male. And so these males were matched either by age or by weight. And so I have varying numbers of trials. I had 10 trials where I had the Fairlawn male with the opponent being a TW2, 11 where it was Fairlawn versus an F1, and 8 where it was Fairlawn versus an F2. And what I get is the following. When it was just the laboratory background, there was no transmission. All of them were from the Fairlawn. There was no T being transmitted in this case. But for the hybrids, surprisingly, what was really shocking was it was almost solely by the hybrid ones. And so for the F1 and for the F2 opponents, these were the winner over 90% of the time. In other words, when we looked at their offspring, the T was being transmitted 90% of the time, over 90% of the time. So that led me to some questions. What accounts for these differences in competitive behavior, right? So maybe it's just a difference in weight, or maybe it's just a difference in how they behave, or maybe it's other differences that we need to explore in terms of reproductive characteristics. So for starters, there is no difference between pairing them by age or pairing them by weight. So we started out with pairing them by age, and then we got a little worried because we realized that these hybrids are bigger, and so then we were like, well, no, we better weight match things. But regardless, that's not an effect. That's not significant. The only thing that is significant is which opponent it is. So, difference in weight, that's not what's accounting for it. Maybe it's a difference in behavior. So, I'm gonna say possibly here, and I'll be honest, I got bumped up a little bit with colloquium. I chose to be bumped up a little bit with colloquium time. And so, pending results, what we start to see is that maybe there is some differences here. So I have been filming the first hour of these interactions. One, I need to, because these mice are competitive, and so I need to be careful. And I need to make sure that I end anything if there was a sign of injury, if what I called a bout occurred, where it was lasting for too long. But I've been quantifying things as I go. I've been counting how many times do they kind of lunge at each other? How many times did the other one flee? You know, how many copulations are there? How many times are they excluded? Does a male try to go into a nest box with a female and she just starts screaming at him, right? They usually run away fleeing. And so what I've seen so far is that counting just the number of fleas, so how many times did the Fairlawn run away versus the opponent, I do see a significant difference here with these F1 hybrids, and that will become important in just a little bit. So again, what accounts for differences in competitive behavior? Not sin. No, possibly. And then, are there reproductive differences? So I've also been looking at these males and their reproductive characteristics. I'm going to again say possibly. What we do see is that we see increased testes weight is often a sign of fertility in mice. So that can be often used as a sign of fertility. And another thing that's been seen by some papers is that an increase in testes weight correlates with an increase in aggressive bouts and how many times they try to be aggressive. Which is interesting because, again, the F1 is the one that's significantly different, and they were significantly different in their behavior as well. So maybe there's a correlation with increased testes weight and how there many times they're willing to start these kind of attacks. All right. So what accounts for these differences in competitive behavior? Again, not weight, behavior possibly, reproductive characteristics possibly, stay tuned. But does it matter, right? Like, who cares if a mouse is more competitive, right? Well, I'm gonna argue that it probably does, especially because, as I mentioned earlier, that T has known fitness consequences. So can you overcome the fact that carrying the T might have some fitness deficits if you can make a really competitive hybrid mouse? And so the next question that I've been asking and spending way too many late nights on is, given two different males, one that has a T, one without, will females have more pups with the male that carries a T? And these two brothers are, they're actually brothers in this case. So this is sperm competition. Maddie, one of our undergrads, has been helping me out. And it's to see if these brother males are paired with the female, who sires the most offspring. So again, they are F1 brothers, so they're 50% hybrid, one that carries a T, one that doesn't. And they're mated with these B6 lab females in varying order. This is actually some of my actual data tables here. And so I want to see who is actually siring this. And I'm just going to screen for whether they have the T or they don't, like I did with those gels. So maybe it just matters who mates first, right? Or maybe there is a huge deficit to carrying the T, something we need to consider. So, linking this all together.
Why did you choose to do that with lab females as opposed to the Farallon females?
That is a great question. So I actually started with Farallon females. And I was having the hardest time telling if they've mated. So when mice mate, they actually form a sperm plug. The male blocks the vaginal opening. And that was not occurring with these Farallon ones that I could easily see. And so just by pure chance, I'd actually had some other set aside that were B6. And so the reason I chose to do that, it's a great question. All right, so this brings me to my ending. That G-Bird is saying that they're taking this phased approach that we've been looking at, where they're following the National Academy of Sciences Engineering and Medicine Gene Drive guidelines. I do want to remind you that here at NC State, we only have mice with a naturally occurring meiotic distortion. So in other words, we don't have the SRY in there. We haven't gotten that far yet. Gene drives need to be considered for spatial and temporal control, has been discussed. Looking for locally fixed alleles, how could you make this unique to an island population? Containment to uninhabited islands. So the thought is, if you could contain this, can you use rodenticides as a failsafe? It's been heavily pushed that there's early on stakeholder engagement. Another chapter of my dissertation is focused on looking at case studies and what could go right with early stakeholder engagement. And again, I just want to remind you that there's lots of questions that remain before that we can proceed further. I have, again, hopefully pointed out to you that I think I may have awoken the Farran strain, right? Wakens the Farran strain with these hybrid mice. I have lots of people who are collaborating on this project. And then I think I will leave time for discussion with some questions, and I'm happy to take any of yours.
Very interesting. I have some questions. So it looks like your back crossing there's a trend of reducing the rate of transmission with more back crossing.
In the transmission?
Yeah. Is that significant, or is it just?
No, and in fact, so Donna, who I got all this protocol from, mm-hmm. has genotyped over 3,000 mice at this point. Yeah, I know, it's a big wow. And she's still at the same rate of 95. I just have a feeling that I'd probably see the same. Yeah.
So I was actually thinking about your sterile SRY individuals.
Yeah.
And I was going to ask some questions along that vein, but it sounds like your Farallon mice don't leave the sperm, or the females don't have a sperm plug when they're mated. Have you looked more into that? Because it would be interesting to see if your sterile males still have some sort of impact on the wild population if you were to, say, release this, right?
So they don't have any. I don't have the SRY in there. It's just with the T.
Right.
But I do have, from another sad story case, some sterile males that I could try and see. But in this case, we know that they reproduce. Why I'm not seeing the sperm plug in the wild females, it could be a difference. I've also been looking at seminal vesicle weights. And so that is a production of this sperm plug. And it's kind of hard to tease apart because age varies as well with the fact of that, but it's something also I've been interested in.
since you're talking about sperm and testes weight, you have possibly for there being behavioral effects or possibly for being physiological effects. But couldn't the physiological differences in the size of the testes be
counting
the
behavior?
Is it increased testosterone?
True. Yeah. And testosterone is something that John and I were talking about lately as maybe another cool thing we could consider as well.
So given all the work that you all put into that website, are you planning on maintaining it into the future, or is it kind of like a historical document, or?
Elizabeth? I don't know. I can't speak for us as a cohort. Again, people have moved on. It's there. I don't know. Iger 2.0 might have some exciting things to add. I'm not sure.
Oh, I was just wondering if you could talk a little more about what it's like when you're working in the mouse barn and what kinds of things have surprised you just in that environment.
People don't give mice enough credit. So truth be told, Jason introduced that I love frogs. I am by background mostly a herpetologist. And so usually when I think of mice before this project, I thought of feeding snakes. which is good because mice are invasive on these islands, right? But yeah, people don't give mice enough credit. And I also think that we tend to think of like a mouse not being a problem. But if you ever want to be horrified, if you've never Googled like mouse plagues Australia, it'll give you nightmares. Because these mice actually are a huge problem, and it's not just islands. So there has been a lot of talk as well about other places. Mice can be a health concern. They actually are a huge contribution to crop losses. So in this case, you know, for now, it's been talking about conservation purposes, but what about the future? You know, I could see, you know, a farmer who has lost everything because of a mouse plague in Australia that tend to happen every 2 years. Wanting maybe this kind of technology. And those questions, I think, will need to be asked and considered.
Okay? That was related to that. Has anybody really asked what would happen to the world if we did get rid of house mice completely?
Yeah, and I know that's been kind of posed with mosquitoes, right? And some people say, oh, it's, you know, we could be fine. Other people have said no, you know. I think you would actually have a huge impact with the loss of mice, especially where they're native. And there's lots of rodents that are native to some of these islands as well. But I don't know if anyone's ever...
Because I was just wondering, I'm sure that competing with other rodents, you know, it could be that, I don't know, cotton rats would take over or something like that.
Sure.
I just don't,
well, and often
so we don't have any data.
Not that I know of. Often rats are actually more of a larger problem.
Yeah.
So some people say, well, why are you working on mice? Well, one, mice are easier to work with genetically. And two, actually, oftentimes there's this huge problem, but you get rid of the rats, and then, wow, I have a mouse problem. It's a competitive release effect, right? They were just kind of holding the mice down at bay, and now you have a mouse problem.
Since you started working on this project, there's a lot of different people in different places all over the world now exploring potential applications of genetic biocontrol for rodents. Lots of different reasons why, lots of different approaches. Which ones catch your eye? Which ones are you paying attention to? And how do you feel about these different sort of ideas that seem to be springing up and becoming more common?
Yeah, I think, one, I try to pay attention to everything that I hear about it, because when we first started, we just didn't hear anything. It kind of felt like, you know, I think we were just kind of like, is anyone else thinking about this? And then, well, lo and behold, other people are. Personally, while I think that this is a great idea, I think that our technology is advancing really fast and that we should also probably consider other techniques, other methods. So with G-Bird, at least, that there's two methods that they're potentially looking at. But I have a feeling in the near future that there could be other. Personally, also, there's been thought of if you could control the population with some type of like birth control kind of thing, Those have also been looked into that I've been kind of interested in as well.
Can you talk about the benefits or the disadvantages of using the Y Strider versus the TSRY a little bit more?
Yes, but I'm biased. So the CRISPR would, in this case, be a lot more efficient in some ways, right? So when we think of CRISPR, we often think of it as being, you know, like almost 100% of the time, those kinds of things. I think if this was in that case, as I said, you might have the benefit of doing a single release. And so you wouldn't have to get everyone together. Even just these traditional rodent neurotic campaigns take a lot of energy, a lot of effort, a lot of financial resources. So there's some benefits there, I think. I have some concerns, just because if you have an all-female population, well, if you're trying to get an all-female population, really it comes down to how many females does a male mate with, right? And so some studies have suggested that maybe it's not as much, but then maybe they can compensate for that, right? Maybe that male goes on overdrive, so to speak, right? Trying to populate all these females. So there's some concerns there. I think there's also, when we talk about gene drive spread, a concern, right? That maybe this would be too penetrating. Again, you would have to make sure that it was locally fixed alleles. With the TSRY, really, to me, the benefit is that it might not be as penetrating. That maybe you know you can contain it because it's going to be kind of self-limiting in that regard. I have some fears over getting the SRY into the T, just because it is large. There also, again, have been documented fitness costs with the T. But I will say that technically, those have mostly been looked at a different form of the T. So there's actually different types of these T haplotypes. And with almost all the other cases, when you inherit two copies, it's lethal. And so they've seen these detrimental effects, but it's mostly been documented where if you inherit two cases, it's lethal, not in this case. So I'm actually really interested to see what will happen with my sperm competition.
What about using CRISPR to make an all-male drive instead of
a
shredder?
That's definitely, again, I think that there's lots of people now thinking of these ideas, and while it's great that we have two, I do think in the future we'll be considering other factors perhaps. But I also think what I have enjoyed about this process is that I'm not just concerned about the genetics, that I'm also concerned about, well, how will people view this, right? And a question I kind of wonder is, will people view this differently, right? Or sometimes I like to say, well, people, how do you prefer it? Do you want like a rodenticide? Or do you want something more species specific? What are the risks and what are those kind of concerns as well?
So if this is self-limiting, is it okay not to eradicate? Is it okay just to be able to suppress the population?
That's a great thing. So I am usually voted down in that conversation. That was a question I raised at our gene drive workshop is, you know, I kind of had this like aha moment of like, well, is it, what if you just lower the population that's no longer causing these detrimental effects? But people have shot me down for that. One, because they're saying, well, you're just going to have to keep releasing, right? You're going to have to keep putting resources into this. The other thing is traditional rodent campaigns, it's really for zero rodents. In fact, they say, you know, one pregnant female is a failure, right? And so I think you'd be, if you're talking to those kinds of groups about these kinds of things, I think that that would be a scary thing to hear, especially from some of the people that I talked to last summer at the Island Invasive Conference. Yeah.
I wonder if you could talk about whether your work on mate choice and sort of lab versus wild is still relevant with thinking about CRISPR, where you might develop the CRISPR technique and just CRISPR the mice from the island where you want to use them. And so then, do you still see it being relevant for those mice, or does that problem go away if you're using a different transformation cookie?
I do and I don't. I mean, presumably you would still be releasing mice. And so those mice would have to be able to survive in the wild. And so even if you use the CRISPR technology, you'd still need to make sure that you had, even if you took the lab population, the wild population, and put it in the lab temporarily, it would be good to know, well, how much time in captivity reduces it. And so like a question I always fear, and that I kind of racks my brain, is, you know, we're using wild-derived, I say, right? These mice were taken, they're onto their eighth generation. Already, we're probably gonna see some differences, right? And so that's another thing is, well, how long can they be in captivity for? That's another kind of concern, right? So, that kind of thing.
I have more questions.
Sorry.
Go for it.
So back to your data, it looked like the F1 was more competitive than the F2. Is that an example of hybrid vigor, or is there something else going on?
So, in terms of overall, it could be, yes, that is one thing that's also been thrown out. Also, it's not like significantly bigger. In fact, it's a little bit harder, to be honest, with the F2s because, at least for me, anecdotally, behaviorally, it was much harder because there was so much more increased aggression that we had to be really careful.
Aggression?
Yeah. It was, that's why we only
Maybe you're breaking up some matings by stopping that?
Yes, yeah. But again, concerns there.
Yeah.
Sorry, to just jump in on this to clarify, the aggression between the two males in the areas was more with the F2s or with the F1s?
With the F2s.
With the F2s.
Yeah.
Was it, have you compared aggression between just wild males? Was it more reflective of a natural aggression?
So I was originally doing a different study where I was comparing what I called secondary invasion, where I had wild versus wild. And so I did one study or two where we just had the feral ones. And it just, I mean, again, it's kind of anecdotal, but we didn't see as much.
So if you think ahead a couple steps, so let's say we have a mouse that has the SRY and the T, and we're setting aside the question about locally controlled gene drives. What sort of mate choice would you want to experiments would you want to see in like a larger facility, like at the USDA in Colorado, with the mice that have the trait, the TSRY mice? How would you want to?
So I am super excited about these SNEs, as they call them, in Colorado, and scaling up. I think an 8-foot by 4-foot is plenty for a mouse, but possibly some of the reason we see such intense competition is that's just not even big enough. So I'm really excited to see with increased density. So we are currently limited by the size of our arenas. So Dimitri, our new postdoc, is actually also looking into making outdoor larger enclosures. So this wouldn't be with the actual TSRY, but just with mice in general to see what happens when you bias the sex ratio. Because we really don't have a good handle on what happens if a population tends to be almost all female versus what happens when a population tends to be all male. And also some exciting stuff with tracking the mice, so seeing where they actually are over time. And he's also been interested in some of this locally fixed alleles as well.
Well, thank you so much. So once again, we'll see you not next week, but in 2 weeks. And for those of you who want to come to the discussion section, let's gather right now and choose a reading for Thursday. So thank you very much.
John.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.